The court is of the opinion that there is no merit to the landlord's contentions, nor to the claim of the landlord that there is no basis in law for the postponement of a portion of the rent increase. The law contemplates that the rentals may vary and that there may be a deficiency in the payment to landlord which would be made up in a subsequent year. The respondent examined all the factors and made a thorough and complete accounting and analysis of the costs and projected costs. He arrived at the figure necessary to enable the landlord to maintain the building and comply with the Act. Recognizing that an application by this landlord for an increase in the tax abatement from 40% to 50% might be acted upon favorably, the commissioner held that an application to modify the second step increase of $1.70 per room in 1966 would be appropriate. He added, however, the summary disposition would not be presently made since additional factors might be presented. One, an estimated 8 cents real estate tax increase. Two, the depletion of the 3% contingent fund because of necessary repairs to the incinerator, as well as three, other extraordinary expenses. It was a proper exercise of his discretion to have the increase in two steps to lessen the impact on the tenants. The fact that the power to do so is not specifically provided for in the Act does not bar such action. The commissioner is given broad powers in the present emergency situation to protect landlords and tenants to the extent that private capital will be encouraged to invest in the construction of house facilities. His action here indicates that the landlord might be delayed in obtaining his 6% return, but will not be deprived of it. Nor has the landlord shown that the two-step increase is against the declared policy of the state. The policy is to encourage private buildings by protecting the investor. The public interest requires that the housing built under the provisions of Article 2 be administered in a manner to attract builders through low-cost public loans and tax abatements to provide housing at the lowest practical rental to low-income families, and if a slight delay in payment occurs, the investment is still fully protected. In any event, the investors are aware that there may be variations in rents and expenses which will curtail the regular payment of interest on the investment, but which will never deprive them of their 6% return. This involves a balancing process between the builders, the tenants, and the state. With respect to the tenant's petition, they argue that the rent increase provision in their lease is void because at the time of the execution they were in an unequal bargaining position, that public policy dictates that the amount of the rental should not be varied until the lease expires, that they are being denied due process and equal protection of the law, that the respondent commissioner was prejudiced, that the delegation of authority by the legislature to the respondent without standards or guides is unconstitutional, and that the lack of diligence of landlord in seeking to obtain tax abatement rendered the granting of the increase arbitrary and capricious. The court finds no merit to these contentions, and some are without legal basis. The first argument has been characterized by the respondent as somewhat bewildering and simply impossible to fathom. The tenants were in the same situation as any other tenants executing a certain condition, but only with the approval of the respondent. Thousands of apartments in our city now are occupied by tenants who have signed leases under conditions of stringency based on a housing shortage, yet the obligation undertaken lose none of their force. If the tenants are correct in their second argument that public policy prohibits a variance of the lease before its expiration, a proposition which has no legal basis, the purpose of the Act would be defeated. The private investors would not be assured of the return on their investment, and would not be attracted to this well-planned method of furthering building construction. Here again, there was no misapprehension by the tenants. It was clearly provided that the rental could be increased during that term, if such was necessary. In any event, they are adequately protected, as the landlord under no circumstances can derive more than a 6% return. The third argument, based on the comparison between themselves and tenants in limited dividend housing projects, can be best answered by stating the latter classification comes under the provisions of a different housing program, under which housing is constructed pursuant to a plan of capitalization which involves private financing obtained by the builder, while in the limited profit housing program, financing is provided by the state directly or through the housing finance agency. Also, insofar as the right to a hearing is concerned, it is clear that a complete hearing was granted them. Reports were filed by division personnel having direct knowledge of the operation, and testimony was taken of witnesses who could contribute to the resolution of the financial factors involved.